بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضله فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، in this last section inshallah of today's seminar, we're going to give you a smattering, inshallah, of mustalah, of hadith terminology. Before we start this hadith, why are we studying it? Firstly, we're not studying in great detail, so just why are we even mentioning it? Firstly, practical benefits. When you see a term sahih, why is it different from hasan? What is a sahih hadith? What is a hasan hadith? What is a da'if hadith? So it's a practical benefit, immediate practical benefit. Secondly, it shows you the preservation of the sunnah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala really has preserved this sunnah by having these type of classifications, so that we know that this hadith is authentic and this hadith is not authentic, this hadith is mursal, mawdu', fabricated, whatever the case might be. Lastly, it shows you the great care and the great efforts that the scholars of the past have done in preserving the sunnah. Without a doubt, this science is unique in the history of mankind. Now, this is something that we say a lot, but not many people realize the repercussions of such a statement. The science of hadith, the preservation of hadith, is something that is unique. Never has it occurred in the past, and never will it occur again. It is of the miracles that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed the Muslim ummah with, and the scholars of the past have explicitly mentioned this, that Allah has honored the Muslims with, for example, the isnad system, the chain of narrators. If you open up Sahih Bukhari, you find a whole chain of narrators. This chain of narrators, Allah has honored the Muslims with it, that it didn't used to exist in the past. Okay, so we have to understand, this is one of the fundamental reasons that people fall into mistakes, because they don't understand this science. It's a unique science. You talk about chemistry, you talk about physics, you talk about anything, it existed. Yes, we've achieved, you know, lots of different ideas and new knowledge and everything, but the basis of those sciences existed. Geology, geometry, mathematics, everything, thousands of years. The science of hadith is something that is unique to the Muslims, and even that in the first few hundred years. After that, in our times, we don't look at the isnad that goes back to the Prophet. No. After Bukhari wrote down his isnad, that's it, end of story. So if you like, for these 200-300 years, a unique phenomena occurred that did not occur ever before, and it never will occur. So this is why the average Muslim, he doesn't many times understand this. And so he falls into errors. The hadith have not been preserved. Likewise, the kuffar, when they usually attack Islam, they don't start with the Qur'an, because they realize to attack the Qur'an is far more difficult. Even though they do attack it, they attack the sunnah. Because to attack the sunnah from their perspectives is easier, because it's so confusing to many people. Not many people have studied the sunnah. Not many people have studied the science of hadith. And here I'll give you a general rule of thumb. Amazingly, when you this you will find without a doubt, every time, when a person attacks the sunnah, write this down, this is a general rule of thumb, he will be the most ignorant with regards to the sunnah. It's a general rule of thumb here. When the person attacks the sunnah, oh, how do you know it's been preserved? Or how do I know this hadith is sahih and da'if? That person would never in his life have opened up Sahih Bukhari and read it. He would never have studied the basic sciences of hadith, much less the advanced or the detailed ones. It's amazing, when a person tries to refute a theory, you will find him to be an expert on it. That's why he'll say, well, the first flaw is here, the second flaw is here, the third flaw is here. As for the people that reject the sunnah, especially amongst the Muslims, you find them to be the most ignorant with regards to the sunnah. So how can you speak about a subject that you have never even studied? Even Ibn al-Qayyim and other ulama, they mention those that deny the sunnah, they haven't even read Bukhari and Muslim. So they don't even know what they're denying. And the more you study the sunnah, the more you study the sciences of the sunnah and the hadith, the more your iman goes up that this science has been preserved. So understand this and realize it, and you can use this as a refutation of those that come to you. He who denies the preservation of the sunnah is the one who is ignorant of the history of the sunnah. It's that simple. Okay? So this is why this science is important for us to study, to appreciate, to realize the efforts the ulama have spent in compiling the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ and in categorizing them. Who is the first one ever to write about this science? The sciences of hadith we're talking about, not the hadith itself. Realize there's a difference. The first one to ever compile a book was a person by the name of, it's a complicated name, Arrama Hurmuzi, who died in 360 Hijri. Does this mean that the sciences of hadith were unknown before this time, 360 Hijri? The answer is a resounding no. Even the scholars of the Sahaba and the Tabi'un and the Taba Tabi'un, they had the rudimentary sciences of hadith established. Ibn Sirin, for example, narrates, Ibn Sirin died 110 Hijri. He narrates, when the fitna broke out, we started asking the people, narrate to us where you heard it from. Before the fitna, we wouldn't ask them. In other words, before the fitna he's talking about is a big fight that occurred between the Muslims, a political thing that occurred in the later time of the Umayyad period. Okay, he's saying, before this fitna broke out, we would accept hadith from anyone because we trusted everyone. Everyone was innocent, naive at that time. Not naive, but they were, if you like, they weren't capable of lying about the Prophet ﷺ. The Tabi'un of that time. The Sahaba, of course, they were above this. But the Tabi'un. Then Ibn Sirin said, when the fitna broke out, when this political strife and struggle broke out, which is a different topic, after this we started asking the people, who narrated this to you? Where did you get this from? So this is the beginning of the science of Isnad. And Ibn Sirin died when? 110. When did he say this statement, the fitna? Some ulama say it was around the 60s of the Hijrah, 40s, 50s of the Hijrah. There's an ikhtilaf which particular fitna he's referring to, but within his life period, within his lifespan, that basically, very early on amongst them in the Muslim history, people started the science of Isnad. You say the Prophet ﷺ said it, who told you? Where did you get it from? Not only that, Ibn Sirin went on. He said, فَيُنظَرُ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِ السُّنَّةِ. We would look at the person of Ahlu Sunnah and we would take his hadith. And we would reject the person of Ahlu Bid'ah and not accept his hadith. The Khawarij, the Shia, the Mu'tazila, those early groups that existed, they would not accept their hadith. Only the person from Ahlul Sunnah that was trustworthy, his hadith was accepted. So this is the basic science of Isnad. You know what the Isnad, which as we're going to talk about in detail, is the list of names. Okay, Imam Bukhari said, my Shaykh Abdullah ibn Yusuf said that, my Shaykh Imam Malik said that, my Shaykh Nafi' said that, my Shaykh Ibn Umar said that, the Prophet ﷺ said. This list of names is called an Isnad. When did it start? As soon as the Sahaba even were alive, but during the time of the Tabi'un. During the time of the Tabi'un. So we find that even though the sciences of hadith were not written down until, let's say, 300 something Hijri, they were existent. And in fact, even if you look up, for example, Sahih Bukhari, you will find many chapters on narrating hadith. How to narrate them. What is the proper methodology of narrating them. Likewise, Imam al-Shafi'i, who was before Bukhari. Imam al-Shafi'i, he has many sections in his book, Ar-Risala, dedicated to talking about the sciences of hadith. But the first one to write a separate book on the subject was this person by the name of Ar-Rama Hurmuzi, followed by a number of people. I have them mentioned in the flyer that's going to be handed out. Until finally, in the year 643 Hijrah, Ibn Salah, a famous alim of Damascus, came and he wrote a book which was so comprehensive and so unique that later on every single book would reference Ibn Salah's work. And Ibn Salah called it Al-Muqaddimah, the introduction. Okay, he called his work Al-Muqaddimah. Every single book that was to be written after Ibn Salah's work, basically it was either an explanation of his work, a condensation, a summarization, adding various points Ibn Salah left out, okay, correcting mistakes. Everything was related to this book. That's how famous it became. So Ibn Kathir, the famous alim, came and he wrote Al-Ba'ith Al-Hathith, Sharh Ikhtisar Ulum al-Hadith, which is related to Ibn Salah's work. An-Nawawi, the famous An-Nawawi, he has two works on Ibn Salah's book. Okay. Likewise, the Suyuti, he has the explanation of Ibn Salah's work, which is the one that is studied in University of Medina. It's a two-volume work on the explanation of An-Nawawi's explanation of Ibn Salah's work. Okay. The point is, Ibn Salah was the one who really defined the sciences of Hadith for later times. And he died 643, but he wasn't the one that invented it. It was invented, the basis of it was existent since the time of the Sahaba. Tayyib, a question arises, why is hadith preservation so different from that of the Qur'an? I mean, the Qur'an is clear, Fatiha Tanas, every Muslim agrees to it. So why is the hadith preservation different? The answer to this is that you have to look at it from a different perspective. That the Qur'an, the Prophet ﷺ ordered that every single verse be written down and he placed it in its proper place. He personally supervised the writing of the Qur'an. As for the Sunnah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed that it was not the case. That the Sahaba, no one ever supervised writing the Sunnah, and if you think about it, it's not possible. Why? Because the Prophet ﷺ is the living sunnah. You cannot write every single thing that he did. You see what I'm saying? The Prophet's life, ﷺ, eating and drinking and sleeping and going, this is the sunnah. How could the Sahaba write all of this? So you have to look at it from a different perspective. Once the Sahaba started narrating it, then later on, all of the fitna and the trials and the turmoil of the Muslim Ummah occurred. People then, devious people, started fabricating a hadith in order to gain some type of acceptance amongst the people. So for example, the first movement that was to attack the Umayyads, okay, they fabricated hadith in favor of their particular tribe. That this tribe is the one that the Khalifa will come from. So they used this hadith in order to attack their opponents. And so fabrication of hadith started. Once fabrication started, not just that, but you had people that were not qualified to narrate hadith, narrating hadith. People with forgetful memories, people with weak memories. Once all of this started, the scholars of hadith needed to come forth with a set of rules, with a set of principles. How are you going to differentiate the weak from the authentic? How are you going to take what is correct and leave what is incorrect? Therefore, the science of hadith emerged and evolved as the times around it changed. So today, of course, it is a well-defined science which you study. Obviously, it is not a living science in the sense that most of this has already been done. You can't really change this science now. It was a science that was used at a certain time, and we use it in our times also, but we use it upon the hadith that are already present in the books, whereas the scholars of those times would use it in hadith that were still being circulated by word of mouth. This is the only difference. So inshallah, today we'll talk about the most important categorizations of hadith. I'm going to use the blackboard here. I hope everyone can see it. If not, then we won't use the blackboard. Bismillah. Tayyib, for any hadith to be considered sahih or authentic, it must meet five basic conditions. Before we get there quickly, we understood what the matan and the isnad is, right? Let me just write it like this, that actions are by intentions. This is a hadith that everyone knows. Actions are by intentions. This hadith is narrated by, who is it narrated by? Umar ibn al-Khattab. Okay, and it was narrated from Alqama, okay, and so on and so forth, all the way down to, for example, Bukhari. This section of the hadith, I'm going to have to stand on one side, so I don't know. This section of the hadith which has the names, can you fix this so I can go further back? This section of the hadith which has the names is called the Isnad, which is a series of names going from whoever compiled the hadith, like Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, all the way to the companion, to the Prophet ﷺ, and that is the isnad of the hadith. This section, let me write down, isnad. This section of the hadith is the matan, which is the actual text of the hadith. Okay. Now the scholars of hadith were interested in both the isnad and the matan. But in general, the isnad is what primarily decides the authenticity of the hadith. The isnad is the primary thing that you use to define the authenticity of the hadith. Because really, if you think about it, this is the crux here, this is the key here. Who told Bukhari this hadith? How was he? What was his memory like? Okay, what was his trustworthiness? Likewise, how about the one that narrated it to Bukhari Sheikh? All the way back to the Tabi'i, all the way back to the Sahabi, all the way back to the Prophet ﷺ. So this is the crux of the hadith. So the scholars therefore said that in order for any hadith to be accepted as sahih, it must meet five conditions, which is what we're going to talk about now. It must meet five basic conditions. The first condition is that it must have a continuous isnad, meaning no breaks in the isnad, no missing links in the isnad. So for example, if I come and I say that Abraham Lincoln said something, everyone's going to say, how did I get this information from? You were not alive when Abraham Lincoln spoke. Likewise, if a person narrates from someone that died before he was born, or that he never met, if he lived his life in Iraq, for example, and that sheikh lived his life in Mecca, and it was known that neither of them traveled, how did you get this information? So then this first condition will not be met. And we'll talk about that in detail, the types of da'if hadith related to the fact that a continuous isnad is not present. The second condition for a hadith to be considered authentic is that all of the narrators must be honest. By honest, I mean they must have integrity. For example, let me give you a practical example in our courts of law. Okay? The cop stands up to testify, and the criminal also stands up to testify. The criminal says, I didn't do it. The two cops say, I saw him do it. Who are you going to believe? And this criminal, for example, is a serial convicted criminal so many crimes before. Who are you going to believe? The two cops. Why? Because they have established, well, technically they should have established, their reputation as being honest, upholding citizens of the law. Whereas this criminal, he is well known that he is an evil person. He is a liar. Or he is a thief, or he is whatever. We're not going to take from him. So we're talking here about the moral integrity. Is this person trustworthy to narrate hadith? Is he so unscrupulous that he will say a lie about the Prophet ﷺ, for example? This is what we're talking about here. In Arabic we call it adala. Adala. So this is the second condition. The third condition is that the person must have precise memory. Now this is very important because this is different from the second condition. A precise and accurate memory. And in Arabic we call this ضبط. Okay, this is very important because you realize the scholars of hadith looked at two separate aspects of the person. Look at how careful they were. There's one thing, a person's honesty. But not every honest person has a good memory. Not every honest person even has the knowledge. And look at, for example, so many of the people in our times that are giving, lectures or whatever, or talking about Islam and giving fatwas, many of them might actually be sincere. It's not as if they are trying to misguide the people. But because they have never studied Islam, for example, or that they don't care to study it or whatever, they are actually giving wrong fatwas, wrong information. I think Islam says this. I think, the hadith is this. Such a person might not necessarily be evil, but because of his ignorance, or because of his inaccurate memory, or because he's not qualified, we cannot accept his statements. Likewise, the scholars of hadith looked at this aspect and they called it ضبط, precision in memory. He might be honest, but when he heard something, was he of a good memory that he could memorize it and then transmit it in the same way that he received it? So there are two separate things to look at the person. The fourth aspect is, and the fifth aspect or something that we're not going to go into too much detail because they're a bit more advanced, is that it does not contradict something stronger than it. In other words, a person who is an average guy, okay, I'll give you another practical example, is that a person says it's going to rain today, okay? You meet someone, for example, he is the weatherman of your locality or area. He tells you, no, I studied the issue, it's not going to rain today. Or inshallah, whatever his predictions are of that time. Or for example, you meet someone who says that so-and-so was in an accident. Then you meet a family member of that person, and he says, no, that wasn't the case. He wasn't in an accident. Here in this case, we have a person that might be honest and have integrity. He might even have a precise and accurate memory. But in this particular case, there was someone that was more knowledgeable than him, more accurate than him, that contradicted his statement. So in Arabic, we call this phenomenon shadh. Okay? Basically, a contradict something that was more stronger than it. Don't write of the conditions you have to be shadh. No. The conditions is you don't have to be. Yani, it's not allowed. No shudud is the Arabic word for the plural. No shudud. Okay, however you want to write that. Don't write shad, because shad is not the condition you need to have, it's the condition you don't need to have. Okay? Questions later on, inshallah, about this. The fifth criterion is that there are no other hidden defects. Hidden defects. In other words, apparently, the isnad might be very correct. You can't find any discrepancy in it. But when you study this hadith and you compare it to other ahadith, you find a hidden defect in it. And that is called in Arabic, illah. So of the conditions is that there is no illah. Okay? Now these four and five are a bit more advanced, but understand these three at least. And we're going to discuss briefly the four and five. The first condition, once again, was that you have a continuous link. No breaks in the chain. Second condition is that the honesty and integrity of the person must be firmly established. The third condition is that not just his honesty and integrity, but also his precision in memory, his sharpness of memory must also be established. The fourth condition is that it cannot contradict something stronger than it. And the fifth condition is that it cannot have any hidden defects. Now, briefly, quickly, we're going to go over 10 or 15 terms. So whoever wants to take notes, better write quickly. And those that are not, inshallah, it's really, as long as you understand these 5 points, that's the most important thing. But so that you are a bit more, a bit more detailed, we want to go a bit more detailed about the various types of da'if hadith, what happens when a chain breaks or whatever. We're going to talk about a few of the more important terms. Okay, so a continuous isnad. What happens when you don't have a continuous isnad? The general term when you don't have a continuous isnad is munqatir. In other words, it's broken. Munqatir. When Adam says the hadith is munqatir, it means that somewhere in the chain, there is a missing link. Where is it? We don't know when he says munqatir. It's a general term. Suppose it was the Sahaba that was missing, the Sahabi himself. For example, Wahab ibn Munabbih, the student of Abu Huraira, said, the Prophet ﷺ said. So the Tabi'i narrates directly from the Prophet ﷺ. We don't know the name of the companion. In this case, this is Mursal. Now we know the missing link, where it is. Mursal is the strongest da'if hadith. Do you understand? Strongest da'if in the sense that all of the other da'if hadith are considered of a lesser category. But it's still da'if. But the strongest of them, even all of the da'if hadith, they, relatively speaking, you can categorize them. The strongest of them is the Mursal. Why is this? Because the Sahaba, obviously, are of the highest level. They can never lie or say anything, mistakenly. So the fact that they're missing in the chain is the weakest type of missing link. Whereas, for example, if a later person were missing, that person might even be a liar. That person might be a person that is rejected by the scholars of hadith. So, but a mursal hadith still is a da'if hadith, but it is the strongest type of da'if hadith. Suppose the person that was missing was at the bottom of the chain, like Bukhari's sheikh, for example. Okay, or more than his sheikh. Yani basically, the missing links occurred right at the bottom of the chain. The person that is above the person narrating, like Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, in this case we call it mu'allaq. Mu'allaq, which means suspended. It's as if the hadith is suspended because it's above the person. He can't really, it's like suspended above him because the sheikh above him has not been mentioned. So it's mu'allaq. It's suspended there. Anytime there are two consecutive missing links. For example, Imam Malik says that the Prophet ﷺ said, Imam Malik didn't even meet any of the Sahaba. Imam Malik narrates from the Tabi'in who narrate from the Sahaba who narrated from the Prophet ﷺ. So there's two people missing here. Anytime there's two or more consecutive people missing, then we call it mu'dal. Mu'dal, which means like confused. Like this hadith is confused because it is it is confusing in the sense that there are two people missing, we don't know who they are. Okay? These are the main types of da'if hadith related to the first condition. The most common term is munqati', which means the break is anywhere. If the break is that of the Sahaba, we call it mursal. If the break occurs at the bottom of the chain, we call it mu'allaq. If the break occurs two people consecutively or more, we call it mu'dal. And obviously, mu'dal is of the weakest of the da'if hadith because there's two people missing. Two generations, maybe 80-year gap in the chain. All of these are da'if hadith. There is one more category in this. It is called mudallas. Now this is, we need to go a little bit more into detail here. Mudallas means that you're not sure that the person actually heard it from his sheikh. You're not sure that the person actually heard it from his sheikh. Certain people were known to practice this act called tadlis. What is tadlis? Tadlis means narrating on behalf of someone whom you never met. Pretending as if you met him. Pretending not as a lie, but it seems like that. Let me give you an example. For example, one of the ulama of our time, Shaykh al-Albani, rahimahullah. Me personally, I never met him. If I were to say, Shaykh al-Albani said, then I am not actually narrating something I heard. It is something maybe from a cassette or a book or something. So if someone were to narrate this, I don't have a direct isnad. You cannot take this as a direct link. We lived at the same time, there's a possibility that we met, but I didn't meet him. Some of the scholars of the past and some of the narrators of hadith, they fell into a mistake. It's not a sin, it's a mistake of known as tadlis, in which they would narrate the hadith in such a fashion that people presumed that the person had met, but in reality he had not met. So that's why it is called mudallas. How do we know this? We have to look up this narrator. Was he known for tadlis or not? If he was known, then in that case, we consider the hadith mudallas, again with many conditions, which we're not going to get into right now. Okay, that was the first condition for a hadith being sahih, that it must have a continuous chain. The second condition was what we called adala, which was what? Integrity and honesty. Suppose the person did not have integrity, he was not honest. In that case, depends on what he was. If he was a liar, if he was a fabricator of hadith, the hadith is known as mawdu'. Mawdu' means the hadith is fabricated. We know for a fact, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that this hadith is not authentic. It is never, the Prophet ﷺ never said it. How do we know this? Because one of the narrators did not have adala. He was accused of lying. Suppose he wasn't accused of lying, but he was accused of being a major sinner. Okay? For example, he would drink, he would womanize, whatever. In this case, such a hadith becomes ضعيف جدا. ضعيف جدا. We cannot accept it, and it's not just ضعيف, it's very weak. ضعيف جدا means very weak. When is it موضوع? If the narrator is a liar. He is known to lie in the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. When is it ضعيف جدا? When his adala is not met, but he is not a liar. When he is not a good Muslim, but we don't know him to lie. So we can't say it's mawdu', so we say it's one category above that, so we say it is ضعيف جدا. By the way, you should know that mawdu' has a number of synonyms to it for practical purposes. Batil, okay, if you hear a scholar say this hadith is batil, basically it is synonymous with mawdu'. Also the phrase, it has no basis, لا أصل له. This hadith has no basis, also is a synonymous with mawdu'. And other phrases too, basically, this category means you know for sure that someone fabricated this hadith and pretended it was a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. And there's one more thing, yes. Suppose the person is unknown, who he is. For example, one person will say, Amr narrated to me that his father said, that the Prophet ﷺ said. We don't know who Amr is, we don't know who his father is. He mentioned the name. He said the name of the person, Amr ibn Abdullah maybe, okay? But we don't have any biographical information about this person. In other words, his status is unknown. Also, this hadith will be considered weak. There is no special term for it. You just say ضعيف here. There's no special term that you use here. But if the person, we say in Arabic, is majhul, he is unknown. So when you don't have any information about the person, and this, by the way, is not as common as you would think. Amazingly, of the miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, most of the narrators of hadith, you have detailed biographies about them, as we're going to mention in a short while, inshaAllah. Okay? But the point is, this majhul, it affects the adala. Why? Because when you don't know somebody, you don't know what his character is. You don't know whether he's good or bad Muslim. So therefore, we consider it as one of the... If this is not met, then the hadith will also be considered daif. The third condition was what? Dhabt, which is precision in memory. Right? Now here we have to go into some detail. People are at various levels of memory. Some of them have excellent memories. They will remember what you say precisely, almost word for word. Others, they will remember what you say, but not as precisely. But they're still, they have good memories. So the ulama differentiated between this. And they said, if a person has superb memory, the hadith will be considered sahih. If he has above average memory, still it's good enough, his hadith will be considered hasan. This is the only difference between the sahih and hasan hadith. Both of them are acceptable in Islamic aqidah, Islamic law, Islamic everything. Both of them are acceptable, but just to show you the precision with which the sciences of hadith were preserved, they even differentiated between someone that was well known for his dhabt and someone that was not as well known. So for example, Al-Bukhari, without a doubt, he cannot be compared to any narrator of hadith who might have adala. You must differentiate between the two. So Al-Bukhari would have been given the status of, for example, his hadith are sahih. His teacher Yahya ibn Ma'in, Ali al-Madini. Such people, they are famous and well known. That if they narrated a hadith, it would be considered of this level. And an average person, like a student of knowledge of his time who was integral, yani he had integrity, he had a good memory, but he wasn't as famous or as well known, his hadith is hasan. But for practical purposes, the two can be used for our level, at this level, synonymously. In the sense that both of them are acceptable in Islamic everything, law, aqidah, fiqh, everything. Suppose now his memory was weak though. In other words, you could not trust him with regards to what he heard and then narrated. He heard something, then he narrated something else. But he's not a liar. In this case, the hadith becomes da'if here. Once again, da'if is a general term. There is no specific term for this. But you can say that it is da'if because his dhabt is not good. It is da'if because so and so, his dhabt did not meet the level that was required of him. Okay? And if his memory is very, very bad, then obviously it becomes very, very weak. Da'if jiddan. So depending on how bad his memory is. Da'if jiddan. So over here in dhabt, you can see that sahih and hasan, this is the only difference between the two. If a person has a weak memory, it'll be classified as da'if. If he has a very weak memory, okay, it'll be classified as da'if jiddan. But a person with a bad memory never reaches a level of mawdu' or fabricated. Okay, because we didn't know that he's a liar. Mawdu' only occurs when you know for a fact this person is a liar. If a person is honest but he has a bad memory, then you say the hadith is da'if or da'if jiddan. You cannot classify it with batil or mawdu' or something of that nature. Okay. The fourth condition of sahih was what? No shudud, right? So over here, basically if a hadith is da'if because of this reason, it is called shadh. The condition is no shudud. If it is, then the hadith is called, the hadith is shadh, in the sense that it contradicts something that is more authentic than it. Let me give you an example here. It is narrated in the Muwatta of Imam Malik that the Prophet ﷺ said, when one of you prays two rak'ahs of Fajr, let him lie down on his right hand side, on his right side of the body. Okay? Now, when we look at this hadith, the isnad of it, it would be at least hasan. Yani the narrators are all acceptable, truthful, everything. But when we look at the other ahadith found in Bukhari and Muslim and so many other works, we find that in fact this was not a statement of the Prophet ﷺ, this was an action reported by Aisha. Aisha said that the Prophet ﷺ, after he prayed two rak'ahs, would lie down on his right hand side. So one of the narrators accidentally, in the sense his memory once yani occasionally failed him, he made it into what? A statement that the Prophet ﷺ said, when one of you prays two rak'ahs of Fajr, let him lie down on the right hand side. How did we know this? Because when we compared all of the other chains, we compiled all of the other hadith, we found that this particular person, and we know who it is, this shows you the precision with which we know the sciences of hadith, this person who was hasan level, he made this into a statement, whereas in fact all of the other people that narrated it, and they were of the sahih level, they narrated it as an action. So then we classify this hadith to be shadh, we give it a special category of da'if. We don't just call it da'if like that, even though shadh is a type of da'if, but because of the fact that all of the people in the chain are good people, are worthy, respectable people, we say it is shadh. Okay? So the hadith that it doesn't meet this criterion, it falls under shadh. The last category, which is the most complicated category, is that there can be no illas. Now just by the term, I'm sure you realize this is more complicated than it looks. No hidden defects. What is a hidden defect? Well, the scholars of hadith have classified 10, 15, 20 different types of hidden defects, which is really beyond the scope of this class. But let me give you an example of what happened, for example, one time, which shows you what an illa is. Basically, an illa means a student of knowledge would look at this hadith with the isnad, and he would think everything is clear and fine. But only the alim, when he compiles all of the other hadith from this person and from concerning this topic, he will be able to see a defect which will not be seen by the student of knowledge. It is obviously only for the ulama. This is where you separate the alim from the student of knowledge. A student of knowledge might study hadith 4, 5, 6, 7, 10 years. He won't be able to make this particular branch his speciality. Only the major ulama, like Imam Bukhari, like Ali al-Madini, like Imam Muslim, they were able to master these ilal, and they were able to point out the hidden defects. Let me give you an example. What happened once, and again this shows you the precision with which the sunnah was preserved, that one of the students of hadith, he wrote his notes with his sheikh, and he walked out of the classroom, okay? And the wind blew, so his notes were mixed up. So what happened was, two pages, when he put them together, they were reversed over. So the isnad of one hadith went on to the matan of another hadith. Everything looks as clear as the day. But Imam Bukhari was able to point out to Imam Muslim and or other people of his time that this person made a mistake here. Because this hadith has never been narrated by this isnad, yet he narrated it. How did he know this? Because of this thing called yani hidden ilal, hidden defects. That two pages were basically swapped around accidentally. So the isnad of one hadith got connected to the isnad or the matna of another hadith. And Imam Bukhari said, this person never narrated this hadith from this isnad, rather he narrated this hadith from this isnad. So what must have happened was, the two hadith got mixed up. And in fact, in reality, the amazing thing is the scholars of hadith recorded this incident. That this student, he got his notebook mixed up, so that he would narrate hadith and he would transform them one isnad to another matan and one matan to another isnad. So the scholars of hadith mentioned this, and Imam Bukhari was able to pinpoint exactly in one hadith where it occurred. The point is, this is a very complex, complicated field, not something that is easy to explain or describe. Because of the fact we say it's a hidden defect, leave it at that, an open thing. Anything could be a hidden defect. How do we find out what is a hidden defect? The ulama, they compile all of the hadith narrated by this person and in this chapter, and then they compare it, and they're able to deduct and determine when there is a hidden defect. And again, there are different types of terms. Depending on what the defect is, you have maqlub, you have muttarib, many types of ilal that the scholars of hadith have defined. Tayyib, there's one more type of, there's two more type of definitions that are important. They're not related to necessarily the authenticity of the hadith, but you will read about them a lot. Mutawatir versus ahad. All of the Prophet's hadith can be categorized as either mutawatir or ahad. Okay? Now, this is nothing to what we just talked about. A had hadith could be sahih, and a mutawatir hadith could be sahih. Okay, what is the difference between the two? Mutawatir means that it has been narrated by a large number of people in every generation. It is beyond a shadow of a doubt something that the Prophet ﷺ said. Whereas a had hadith is something that has not been narrated in this number, in this fashion. Now, why do we care so much about this? In reality, the fact of the matter is that the scholars of the past did not care that much about it. They did not care that much about it, because any hadith that comes from the Prophet ﷺ is a hadith. However, what happened was, the scholars of innovation, they came and they tried to destroy the sunnah by another method and another manner. And they said that, well, let us differentiate the hadith between mutawatir and ahad, then we will reject the ahad and take only the mutawatir. And by doing so, they basically rejected the sunnah. Why? Because most of the sunnah is in ahad hadith. So we find that the Mu'tazila, for example, they say we will not accept ahad hadith. But now the problem arises when you reject ahad hadith, you reject most of your fiqh also. So the Mu'tazila said, okay, we'll not accept ahad hadith in matters of aqidah only. But we will accept in matters of fiqh, which is a contradiction. And to this day, this ideology is present and rampant amongst many Muslim groups. We don't want to mention any names here, but a very large and famous group in our times that denied ahad hadith. Sunni Muslim group. They say we will not accept ahad hadith. They claim themselves Sunni. I mean, they're not Sunni by saying this. We will not accept ahad hadith in aqidah. To this day, this type of ideology remains. So I just want to point out that yes, there is a difference in that mutawatir has been narrated by a large number of people. Ahad has not been narrated by a large number of people. But for practical purposes, every sahih hadith needs to be acted upon or believed in. There is no benefit, practical benefit, for dividing the hadith into mutawatir and ahad. Yet the scholars have done it just for the sake of knowledge, and the scholars of bid'ah have done it for the sake of destroying the sunnah. So keep this in mind. You will hear this phrase a lot, by the way, that ahad hadith cannot be used. Ahad hadith are not a source of knowledge. Ahad hadith cannot be relied upon totally. And this is, all of this is from the Mu'tazila that has affected the groups of our times. So whenever you hear this, realize that this is not the position of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. In fact, Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah has a whole few chapters in his Ar-Risala about this concept here, where he defends that hadith need to be used. Imam al-Bukhari, in his Sahih, in his Jami' al-Sahih, he has a whole kitab, a whole chapter dedicated to showing you that hadith can be used. And he entitles it, Kitabu Akhbar al-Ahad, that the hadith of Ahad. So all of these scholars of the Sunnah, they used to refute the scholars of the Bid'ah when they said this. Unfortunately, in our times, those that claim to follow Bukhari and Muslim, they haven't read Bukhari and Muslim, therefore they try to deny a hadith ahad. Another important category that we have to talk about is, where is this hadith ending? For example, who said it? Did the Prophet ﷺ say it? Or did the Sahaba say it? Or did the Tabi'un say it? And depending on where it ends, the scholars have given names for each of these things. So the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that goes directly up to him, in other words, the Sahabi says, the Prophet ﷺ said, this is called a marfu' hadith. It is raised. Marfu', it was raised all the way to the Prophet ﷺ. The meaning of marfu' is that the phrase qala Rasulullah ﷺ occurs. If the Prophet ﷺ said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, then it becomes a hadith, what? Qudsi. Okay? So if the Prophet ﷺ says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, it becomes hadith Qudsi. If the Sahaba said that, whatever he said, like Abu Bakr said something, Umar said something, you don't call it a hadith, but you call it mawquf. This is a mawquf statement. Mawquf means it's been stopped. Stopped right before the Prophet ﷺ. Now the mawquf statements of the Sahaba, they occupy a position in our religion in that we benefit from them. And we look up to them. And we respect those statements of the Sahaba, but they don't have the same legal weight as the Sunnah. Suppose the Tabi'i made the statement, one generation under the Sahaba, we call that thing maqtur. Maqtur. Maqtur means cut off. So the hadith, it's as if it has been cut off. The first two generations have been cut off. And the statements of the Tabi'in also are important in our religion, but under that of the Sahaba. And both of these are under that of the marfu' and the hadith Qudsi of the Prophet ﷺ. So before we conclude, I want to talk a little bit about the science of Rijal. Science of men. The science of men doesn't mean we study men, we study the biographies of men. The hadith, the people, the men who narrated the hadith. This is really a very long and large science, but it was one of the earliest sciences ever in the Muslim Ummah. Because even before Bukhari and Muslim and others wrote their books of Sahih, people had already started compiling books of Rijal or men. What is the books of Rijal? The books of Rijal basically are books related to discussing the biographies of the narrators of hadith. So we have books written about other people. You look up the isnad, the names that we mentioned here, there are books that you can go back to that talk about these people. Now this is something, like I said, is unique to the Muslim Ummah. It does not exist so much detailed information about three generations of Islam, the Sahaba, the Tabi'un, the Tabi'un, and even the generations after them, one or two. Any scholar of that period, we have books written about him. You can look him up alphabetically, his name, his father's name, look him up, what the scholar said about him, how reliable he was, the other ulama that tested him, what level of precision he has. All of this has been recorded, and this is something that is difficult to conceive. And I wish we had some of the books here, I will show it to you. Only when you read these books do you realize and appreciate how this religion has been preserved. Because had it not been for this science of men, ilm al-rijal, the hadith would not be preserved. Every single narrator found in every single book of hadith, there is at least his name is mentioned in these books. And in some rare cases, like we said, there will be majhul, that we don't have any information regarding him, but his name will be found there. That yes, this person did narrate hadith in this time frame, but we don't really have information about him. But the majority of narrators, let me just put an estimate, like maybe 90% of the narrators of hadith, of any books of hadith, you will be able to know a biographical sketch of him, when he was born, where he lived, who his shuyukh are, okay, who tested him, what did the scholar say about him, who his students were, where he narrated hadith, any problems he might have had, everything. And this is amazing. For example, in when I was in second year, we had a whole year-long class called The Science of Men, Jarh wa Ta'dil, if you like. We studied over 90 books written about this science. 90 books, the entire book is just a list of names. And these names will tell you what the scholar said about him. Imam al-Bukhari, for example, has Tariq al-Kabir. This Tariq al-Kabir that Bukhari wrote, all it is a collection of names, 12,000, 9,000 names. You just look up a name and you find what Bukhari said about him. Okay. Likewise, Imam al-Nisa'i, Imam Muslim has some books. Before them, Imam Ahmad has many books his students compile off of him. And this is something you really have to see to appreciate. The fact that these men have been talked about, discussed, and when I went to third year in my College of Hadith, my yearly research paper was about one man. The entire year, from the beginning to the end, right, I had to do a comprehensive research about one person. Ikrimah ibn Ammar was his name. This man, I had to go back to every one of these 80-90 works and see what the scholar said about him and try to finally decide what was the correct opinion about this guy. And I wrote on computer 40-50 pages about this guy. And he was not one of the major scholars of Hadith. Ikrimah ibn Ammar, who has heard of him? Hardly anyone. You know. Yet I was able to write a 40-50 page. I'm not saying this about myself, I'm saying this about the science. That look, one man who is an average person, Ikrimah ibn Ammar, he's not one of the big guys. One of the big guys, you write PhDs about them. Right? Yahya ibn Ma'in, he has a few PhDs. Ali al-Madini, he has a few PhDs done on him. But as for these minor players, if you like, someone like me comes along and he can write 1,400 years or 1,200 years later, a 40-50 page research paper about when he was born, where he lived, where he traveled, okay, who he studied from, who his students were, what all of the ulama before him, not before him, obviously, in his time and after him, said about him, whoever talked about him, what hadith he narrated, okay, all of this was done on this man. This shows you that this is, no wonder the kuffar are jealous of us about this science. And no wonder when it is so complicated and confusing that many Muslims fall into mistakes about this. Okay, I just want to mention some of the more important works and then we'll conclude at that inshallah, of Jarh wa Ta'dil. Basically, the earlier works, like what happened to hadith literature, the earlier important works, right, they were absorbed into the later works. So the earlier works, although they are still existent, only the scholars and the students of knowledge go back to them. The students of knowledge of hadith, not even any student of knowledge. Only the specialized people of the people of the field in the field of hadith will have these 80-90 works that I talked about that were written 100 Hijri, 200 Hijri, 300 Hijri, 400 Hijri. Every generation has 15, 20, 30, 50, 40 works to it. As for our times, the beginning student of knowledge, if you just want to study a little bit of hadith, the first book you'll buy, or the two, three main books you'll buy, we'll just talk about them. So you get an idea of what's going on here. The biggest and most important of these works is Tahdhib al-Kamal. Tahdhib al-Kamal by someone called Al-Mizzi. Al-Mizzi was a very, very close friend and student and of Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah. Okay, he was around the same time, from 726 of this, around that time, he passed away. Okay? Tahdhib means condensation, a condensed version. So this book is a condensed version of Al-Kamal. Al-Kamal was written 120 years ago. Okay, and I want to, something interesting that everyone should know. This book, the original Al-Kamal, who does it talk about? It talks about the narrators of all of the six books, the Kutub al-Sitta that we talked about. In fact, it was because of Al-Kamal that we have this term, the six books. Where did it come about? Who was the one that invented the term? Why do we have these six books that are different from the others? Because this person, not Al-Mizzi, Al-Kamal was Abdul Ghani Al-Maqdisi, okay, who wrote Al-Kamal. He did such a thorough job, such a perfect job of compiling the names of all of the people. Remember, this is not just the Sahaba. This is from the Sahaba down to Imam Bukhari. All five, six generations of all of these six books, he compiled them from the original source works. Okay, you following me here? Right? He compiled them from the original source works, and he did such a good job of it, that because of him, and because he chose these six books, the six books became the six books. That because so much benefit was in Al-Kamal of Abdul Ghani Al-Maqdisi, they said these six books, people started studying them even more, because of the simplicity of finding a person in Al-Kamal. Okay, so then Al-Mizzi came along 120 years later, and he condensed it, Tahdhib al-Kamal. Do you know how many volumes this is published in? 37 volumes. Tahdhib al-Kamal fi Asma' al-Rijal. Even I don't have this work. It's too expensive. Okay, it's in print. Amazing. It's in print and available. If you go to Jordan or Syria or Arabia, any country that specializes in this, it's available. Okay, this is Tahdhib al-Kamal of al-Mizzi. Obviously, 37 volumes is not something you can carry around and benefit from. So comes al-Hafiz ibn Hajr, the Imam of the Muhaddithin, and the one that really closed the door to ijtihad, if you like, or I shouldn't say that, but I'm saying he perfected the science of hadith of his time, and he wrote Tahdhib at-Tahdhib. What does that mean? Who can tell me? The condensation of the condensation. Okay? This one comes down to a reasonable 4 thick volumes in small print. Okay, this is what I have here, Tahdhib al-Tahdhib, and this is very, very comprehensive for a beginning student of knowledge, for beginning level. This book, if you have it, again, this only deals with the 6 works. The 6 works. It doesn't deal, for example, the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, or the Musnad of Al-Tayalisi, or the Musnad of Al-Darimi, or the Sunan of Sa'id ibn Mansur. You might and you might not find the guy. If that guy is found in the 6 works, you'll find it in here. If he's not found in the 6 works, you will not find it in Tahdhib al-Tahdhib. You have to go to other works, which we're not going to mention. We don't really have time for that. But even his students complained of this. They complained it's too big, Tahdhib al-Tahdhib. So comes along Ibn Hajar again in his lifetime, and he writes Taqrib al-Tahdhib. Taqrib means making something close to you. So the Tahdhib is too far away from you, so he'll make it Qareeb. He'll give you Taqrib of Tahdhib. Okay? So this is Taqrib of the Tahdhib of the Tahdhib of the Tahdhib of the Kamal of the Kamal of al-Mizzi. And this is a very reasonable 1 volume, and some have it in 2 volumes. It's basically every single narrator has 2 lines to him. 2 lines, 1 or 2 max. Nothing, never more than 3 lines. Whereas al-Mizzi, you could literally have 10-15 pages about one man. So Hafiz ibn Hajar then condensed this into a few paragraphs for each person. And then in this work, Taqrib al-Tahdhib, he has 1 line. His full name, his full kunya, when he died, and what his level is. That's it. His level meaning, is he his loved level? Is he acceptable? Is he not acceptable? Is he trustworthy? Whatever. His final verdict. Ibn Hajar's final verdict. And this is the standard thing, that the beginning step that any person goes back to for any ilm al-rijal thing, he goes back to this statement. Now we didn't get into, neither are we going to, about how the ulama decided who was acceptable. Suffice to say that that too is a science in and of itself. They would test the people, they would examine them. It is well documented. Imam Ahmad would go to a person and recite to him the hadith that he took from him, then come back after 5-10 years and ask those same hadith to see how his memory was. Okay? And other instances of this nature, so then they would document his memory, his precision. And the books of hadith are filled with such type of anecdotes and incidences that prove to you that that is a science in and of itself. And one last point, what do we do with da'if hadith? The important question. Obviously, mawdu' hadith, without a doubt. Mawdu' fabricated hadith, nothing to do with them. Da'if jiddan, very weak, also nothing to do with them. This is unanimous consensus. None of the scholars says this. Sahih and hasan, we take them, all of them. The ikhtilaf comes with da'if hadith. What do we do? There are 3 opinions, quickly. The first opinion is that you accept them in general, without much conditions put. And this is the opinion of 1 or 2 scholars. It was really an unknown opinion or not really followed. The second opinion, which is the opinion of many ulama, is that you accept them but with certain conditions. With certain conditions. These conditions are, number 1, that the hadith not to be very weak, just slightly weak. Number 2, that the hadith be in a chapter concerning something that is not fard or wajib or haram, but is something that is encouraged. Okay, targhib and tarhib. Something that is encouraged. Okay. And number 3, that when you do this hadith, you don't really believe, you realize it's a da'if hadith, so you don't really believe that you're going to get the reward that is mentioned in the hadith. Okay? These are 3 conditions mentioned by some of the ulama, and that's their opinion. But really the stronger opinion for our practical purposes, and the last opinion, the 3rd opinion, is that the average layman should not touch da'if hadith. He should stay away from da'if hadith. Why? Because the layman is not qualified to put these 3 things into action. And That's the first reason. The second reason, which is really very important also, that we have enough sahih and hasan hadith in order that we can start acting upon if we want to, that we don't have to start scribbling over the da'if hadith. There are so many sahih and hasan hadith, why should we get involved with the da'if ones? When we know for a fact that the Prophet ﷺ said something, why should we argue and get into facts, a gray area that we don't know for sure whether he said it or not? You want to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Trust me, there are plenty of sahih and hasan hadith that we're not doing that we could do. And a person could live his whole life doing them without getting involved with the da'if hadith. So really, for practical purposes, and this is the opinion of Shaykh Al-Bani and many of the ulama, it is better, much and strongly encouraged, if not obligatory, for us laymen to stay away from da'if hadith, to rely upon the sahih and hasan hadith. With that, inshallah, we'll open the floor for questions. And I have one, not just this sheet, but another sheet talking about books for further reading. And there's three levels: beginning level, intermediate level, advanced level. All of them are in English. If you'd like to benefit from them, no questions. It's Salah time, inshallah. Okay, subhanakallah.